morning, church. Welcome to Great Commission Community Church. It's good to be here together. And we gather every week just like this because we believe that God meets us here in our worship. He meets us in a special way as we give our devotion to God and as we celebrate who God is and what he does. We thank God together collectively as a church. We repent, we lament, we rejoice collectively as a church, and we listen and we speak and we sing and get sent into the world. God meets us in all of those pieces. And in fact, God invites us to draw near to meet him and to know him. One invitation comes through the apostle Paul and his prayer for the church in an ancient Greek city called Ephesus. I pray that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give you the spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of him, having the eyes of your hearts enlightened, that you may know what is the hope to which he has called you, what are the riches of his glorious inheritance in the saints, and what is the immeasurable greatness of his power toward us who believe. So church, as we enter this time collectively, I invite you, if you're able, to stand and sing.
My heart, Lord, stood a precious tree.
Just to know his name.
chains of the world. His blood breaks the chains, and every knee will bow before the Lion and the Lamb. Every knee will bow before Him. Who can stop the Lord?
Actually honor each other. Could we turn to someone in this moment and just say to them, the peace and power of Christ to you.
Morning, good morning, peace of Christ to you. Welcome to our Sunday service. For those I haven't got to meet yet, my name is Chris, one of the pastors here at our church. We just have a few things that our church does and that we just want to highlight is important to our community. First is we have what we're calling an equipping day. And so if you've been at a church for a while, you would have known our church rhythm is we have like a lot of awesome classes that we offer throughout the year. But we felt like, man, that's so hard to keep track of, like when all the classes are, and it's hard to schedule things. And so we felt like, hey, why don't we just have all the classes, most of the classes, happen on one day? And so how the day is structured, there's going to be four different like classes you can sign up for in the morning, and then we'll break for lunch, and then four classes in the afternoon. And so these are some pretty amazing classes. They go from, as our church is in the blessed practices, they'll talk about how do you bless people at work, especially when it's like you're not supposed to talk about Jesus at work. Like, how do you do that at work? We'll have classes like American church history, and we'll talk about politics in this election season. We'll have a class on how do we do global missions in a way that's honoring to the Lord, honoring to the people who were like the places that we're going to. And so there's going to be a lot of different classes. Registration starts next week, and you can find which classes next week. Next week, we're not here. We're at Virginia Highlands Park. And so that's the little picnic area behind the playground. We love our outdoor services. They're a great time just to hang out after. We're going to have lunch afterwards. And so come, invite your friends. It'll be Virginia Highlands Park, same time, 11 a.m. One important thing. Our international workers, our missionaries who recently returned, Renee and Leo, from a country we call Tea House. They'll be here with us next week. And so that'll be a great opportunity just to sit with them, just to hear from them, and just to get to know them as this is a couple we've been supporting for a while. On that same day, later on, in that early evening time from 4 to 7, Ryla, Restoration Immigration Legal Aid, who we've been starting to get to know more this summer, they do pro bono work for a lot of families and really children seeking asylum. And so this is a great Christian missionary organization who we're trying to get to know better. We're trying to just support better as a church. But they're going to have a family picnic, which is their staff, their volunteers, and also their families who they're helping. They're going to come. And so it's going to be in Alcova Heights Park. It's about just like a 10-minute drive to the west. If you have kids, bring your kids. They're going to have a bounce house. And there's going to be food and just games. And so it's just going to be a good time. So we want to invite you to come and just join us. The week after that, September 15th, we have a welcome lunch. And so if you've are newer to our church, you haven't been to a welcome lunch yet, this is a great way to get to know us better. There's going to be just some church leaders there where you can just ask questions, get to know us get to know you. And so we're asking that you RSVP for it so we can know how much lunch to get. You can find that on our website under events. And then, super excited, our small groups. Registration starts today. And so small groups is an integral part of our church life. We don't believe Christians are called to walk this life alone, but we're called to do it together. And at our church, we believe one of the best ways is through our small groups, where we'll regularly meet, study the Word of God, pray together, but also do this like life called like being a believer, being a Christian, and like do it together. And so registration starts today. Small groups start next week. And so the week of like next week, the week of the 8th, they'll start. And so we want to encourage you, go online. There's different, like every day, almost every day, Tuesday through Friday, there's ones scattered throughout this general area, general DMV area. And so registration is a little different this year. There's no like form. Registration just means like contacting the small group leaders. And so there's going to be an email that you can send to them and tell them you're interested. Along with small groups, we have something called Life on Life. So Life on Life, if you've been at a church for a while, which I actually haven't been to a church that long to know about it. So I'm just like, this is what I've been told. But it's this awesome discipleship cohort that's usually offered as a class, and it's like pretty intense. There's like, it's basically like, if you've been following our church in the summer, our discipleship pathway, like these are like what we believe like followers of Jesus like should do, from like prayer to like believing and working towards like Christ's cause. Like it's doing that actually together in a class. And so we've kind of converted that class into a small group. And so it's going to be the same time as small group from September through May. And how it's broken down is like the first week is a general like lesson, like a large group lesson. And then weeks 2 and 3, you'll be broken up into smaller groups of like 3 to 4 people to kind of discuss that lesson. There's like some homework assignments, so it's like pretty intense. And then the fourth is, I think, like a practical, like you actually go and like there's like an event that you actually go and do. And so this is kind of like a small group that's like really intentional. So if you feel like that's the season where you're at, I've heard amazing testimonies of people who've gone through this class. And so this is a great way for if you want something just a little more intentional than just a regular small group. But you can find that info on our website too, under small groups. Scroll all the way down. There's going to be a little description of Life on Life. Our last but not least, we have a video from one of our international workers. If we can cue that. Yeah, as our church goes through blessed practices, that's what we're hoping. We're hoping that these are just organic ways that we are just blessing the people that God has placed around us, not in any like weird ways, but any just like very natural ways. And so they are a couple who we sent out from our church. And on Tuesday nights, we actually pray together every Tuesday on Zoom. And this Tuesday, they're going to be there. And so you'll get to hear more about them. Like, we'll get to pray with them and pray for them. And so we just want to invite you to join us on Tuesday. Our church does not do a traditional offering box during the offering time. We have all our giving online, but we still want to intentionally dedicate this time and dedicate our tithing to the Lord. And so let me pray for us. Lord, I thank you that as we sing about, you've given us an immense wealth. And God, we thank you so much for that. God, we pray that as you've given us this immense wealth, God, we don't want to seek to use it for ourselves, but God, we want to seek to bless others with it. We want to seek the goodness of others. And so, God, we pray that as you continue to work in our church, that God, that you continue to grow our hearts for others, people who are easily overseen, that God, that you would help us be the means by which you want to bless them. And so, God, thank you. God, be with us here in our space today. God, we welcome your Spirit to come and work in our minds, in our hearts. God, come and be here. We praise you. We bless your name. God, in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
All right, good morning, everybody. Hey, I'm Carl. This fall, our sermons are going to be going through the book of Luke, and they're focusing on what Chris talked about, what we're calling blessed practices that we see in this book of Luke. Again, if you're like, wait, what is bless again? Or if you're here for the first time, you're like, what is bless? It's actually capital B-L-E-S-S. So it's not just bless, but it's bless. And they stand for begin with prayer. So I said last week how that's kind of cheating, because actually like plus, because it's really pray, you know, but we wanted to make it bless, so we inserted begin with. So it's begin with prayer, listen, eat together, serve, and I'd say and be served, and share story. And today we're mostly talking about beginning with prayer. So we're in the book of Luke. We're going to be looking at Luke chapter 1 today. Luke is a really great book. Well, like all the books of the Bible are. Luke, the writer, was a doctor. He was a partner and companion of Paul, like I guess a missionary doctor. He was an educated guy. He's a careful writer. He actually talks about his methodology in the first paragraph of the book, like how he did research and how he put together this account of Jesus' life. He has a lot of stories about Jesus and the marginalized specifically, even more than the other gospel writers. So just a little bit of background on Luke. So please turn with me to Luke chapter 1, and we're going to be starting in verse 26. Verse 26 of chapter 1, and I'll just say, you know, that this passage is mostly about Jesus, and the main point of the passage here, I think, is to tell the characters here, specifically Mary, and us as the readers, who Jesus is, and if we're talking about BLESS practices, we could just say that the ultimate BLESS practice is that God sent Jesus to us, but there are multiple messages we can receive for any Bible passage, and today, even though this passage is mainly teaching us who Jesus is, I think this passage also invites us to consider a couple people here, a couple women, Mary and Elizabeth, as people who bless. Specifically as people who pray. So we're going to read from verse 26 to verse 45, but before we do that, please pray with me one more time. Lord, we thank you so much for your word, and we thank you for your presence here speaking to us, your Holy Spirit speaking to us. Lord, author of this scripture along with Luke, you Holy Spirit speaking to us as we read, as we consider these words together. We're so thankful, Lord, for who you are, what you do, what you've done, what you will do. Lord, our posture before you right now as we think and as we listen and as we pray, Lord, we want that posture to be one that is just open to you, one that is full of faith, one that is, Lord, able to receive and say yes to you continually. Lord, thank you for shaping us this way. Shape us right now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Verse 26, in the sixth month, so real quick, right before this, a woman named Elizabeth, an elderly woman named Elizabeth, became pregnant miraculously. And so in the sixth month, that is the sixth month of her pregnancy, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a young woman or a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And this young woman or virgin's name was Mary. Verse 28, and he came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." I read that as very, very even keeled. Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you. But I don't know if it was shouted, it was whispered, we're not quite sure. But then Mary's reaction, verse 29, is that she was greatly troubled at this word, at this saying, at this greeting, and tried to discern. She was perplexed. She was wondering what sort of greeting this might be. And verse 30, the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary." And that's typically what angels say. That's usually one of the first things angels will say to people when they appear. Like, don't be afraid, because angels are very scary. Very scary, because they're described in the Bible as just like ginormous, like wings, you know, just like crazy scary if you actually saw them. You know, I know in our culture, like, angels are like little babies, like with wings, you know. I mean, they're scary in their own way. But this is, like, just scary, you know. So always the angels will say, peace, like, don't be afraid, okay? And Mary, maybe there is a mix of fear as well as what Luke describes as being perplexed. Like, what is this angel saying? I don't know what to make of this. Verse 30, the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. You favored one." Verse 31, And behold, you will conceive in your womb and bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, which in Hebrew means God saves. Verse 32, he will be great and will be called Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will give to him the throne of his father David. That is, this is a king, an incredible king. And he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there will be no end. And verse 34, Mary said to the angel, "How will this be?" Like, continuing in her confusion, figuring out what this all means. "How will this be, since I am a virgin?" And in Greek, it's translated like, "Since I'm a virgin," in Greek, it's just, "since I do not know a man." Since I do not know a man. It's not the same word that's sometimes translated virgin, sometimes translated like young woman earlier in the passage. But like, how can this be? Because I do not know a man. Like, I'm abstinent. So how am I pregnant? Verse 35, and the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God." And behold, on top of that, behold, I mean, I'll read that again, verse 35. This is craziness. And the angel answered her, "The Holy Spirit will come." Like, I don't know a man. How am I going to be pregnant? "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. Therefore, the child to be born will be called Holy, the Son of God." What? And then on top of that, verse 36, "Behold, your relative Elizabeth in her old age, your old cousin Elizabeth, has also conceived a son." And this is actually the sixth month with her who was called barren. "For nothing will be impossible with God." And Mary said, "Behold, I am the servant or slave of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word." And the angel departed from her. It's an incredible account of Mary. Let's just go ahead to verse 39. Again, we'll read about six more verses. In those days, sometime around then, Mary arose and went with haste, into the hill country to a town in Judah, and she entered the house of Zechariah and greeted Elizabeth, that is Zechariah, Elizabeth's husband, and went to their house because she was excited about this news that the angel spoke to her. Verse 41, and when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, so Mary comes in, Mary says hi, like, hello, I'm here. And when Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, the baby, so again, this is about the sixth month, the baby leaped, jumped, skipped, big kick, something, in her womb. And Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaimed, she cried out with a loud cry, she shouted with a loud cry, I won't do it here, it's too loud, but just imagine with me. Should I just say it real loud? Okay, I'll say it real loud, but away from the mic. I'm sorry, I should have practiced this. Blessed are you among women. Blessed are you among women. And blessed is the fruit of your womb. And why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, a baby in my womb leapt for joy. And blessed is she who believed that there would be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord. Just real quick on the last couple verses, last few verses. Why is this granted me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy. And blessed is the one who believed, is she who believed that there will be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her from the Lord. So apparently when Mary came in, like the baby kicked. And somehow in that baby's kick, she's new. Mary is going to be pregnant with Jesus. You know, it's just somehow, through the Holy Spirit, it was just very clear to her. Sometimes, I don't know, for me, it's like, partly that's just people in the Bible, they just, somehow the Holy Spirit comes and just people get it. Partly to me, it's like, it's sort of like old world women, I don't know. Like, I remember, it sort of reminds me of like when my wife and I were pregnant with our first baby, and I told my mom, like, I was going to tell her over the phone, like, hey, you know, we're pregnant. And then, so I'm talking to her on the phone and saying, we're pregnant. Big news, we're pregnant. And then she says, oh, I knew. I'm like, well, how'd you know? She's like, I had a dream. You know, I was like, oh, what was a dream? Squash. You know, it's like, what? You know, you got that from, you know, but it was very clear to her, you know. Somehow, baby kicked. It was very clear to Elizabeth. This is Jesus, you know. And so that's what we have in this. Blessed is she who believes. Blessed are you, Mary, who believes that there will be a fulfillment of what was spoken to her. The first B of this blessed thing that we do here, that we're doing here this fall, the first B is about prayer. So how do we pray? And I think Mary and Elizabeth are good guides for us here at the start of Luke. By the way, it seems best, I think, to feel like the Bible isn't meant to be like an exhaustive guide on how to pray. Like if a way of praying isn't in the Bible, then it must not be good or right. And I think there's room for creativity. But actually, that said, I think the Bible tends to be a lot more creative than we are when it comes to prayer. There's lots of examples of prayer, some of them very odd, some of them very unexpected, that we can find in the Bible. And so today, we're just going to look at prayer from these two sisters in Christ, Mary and Elizabeth. And we always do this. We have three things that we're going to think about. Three things that we're going to think about from this passage about prayer. So first, when we begin with prayer, when we talk about beginning with prayer, I think when we read a passage like this, we realize it's not just like praying for specific things or specific words or requests that we have. A lot of it is just developing and sustaining a posture, like a certain posture, a certain just way of being before God. And when we look at Mary in verse 38, she says, behold, she hears this crazy thing from God. And she says, behold, I am the servant of the Lord. Let it be to me according to your word. That's an amazing prayer. It's an amazing prayer. And so I think when we talk about prayer, just first thing, we want prayer that is about us being ready with faith in God's word, ready to say yes to God. Just to say, I am a servant of the Lord, ready for surprises, ready for the unexpected. Not just a one-time prayer, but a habit and a posture of prayer. You know, Mary is listening to God via his proxy in this story, his visible angel. And basically, her listening to the angel is her listening to God, and her talking with the angel is her talking to God. And it's helpful to note also, just to remember that Mary is, like, this character, Mary, this person, the sister in Christ, is venerated. And we're not a church that believes in her sort of perpetual virginity or believes that even like virginity itself has some kind of like mystical power or something. But in the Bible, actually, there's just a few passages about her, but they're powerful. Like we know that she's a young, poor woman. She says, here, I'm a servant of the Lord. In the next section, she actually sings prophetically about a new world where things are flip-flopped, where the rich are brought low, the poor are exalted. And then in the next chapter, she receives this amazing word about like her in relation to her son Jesus, that she's going to have to let him go, that it's going to be painful for her too to be a disciple of Jesus. She's really an amazing person. But even if we don't like kind of treat her as like too much, man, she is awesome. And in this prayer, in this interaction with God through his angel, I mean, we see her being troubled and fearful. We see her like not understanding things. So I think what Mary models for us is not just prayer with like one emotion, without pauses, without feeling troubled, without having any questions. No, it's with these things, but in that, there's a posture. It's a posture of faith, of saying, yes, I trust you to God. You know, when I pray sometimes, I don't say anything. I don't say anything when I pray sometimes. And it's not because I fell asleep. It's not because like I'm trying to practice mindfulness or something. It's just reverence. It's just faith. It's just knowing how tremendous God is, how beautiful Christ is, how close his spirit is. And also I think here it's not just faith like generally, as if having faith just means you're like an optimistic person. And it's not just faith in God either, generally, as if having faith means you're just willing to believe in things that are supernatural. It's specifically faith in God's word. It's faith in what God speaks to us and lets us know. You know, a lot of people believe that Jesus was a real person who existed and who died on a cross 2,000 years ago. But Christians believe that it's not just that, because they believe Jesus' words about that death, that his death was for the forgiveness of sins. Christians have faith in what he said about his resurrection too, that his resurrection means that all of us will be resurrected just like he was, and how he said he is returning to this world to make all things new. You know, prayer is not just words, it's about a posture. Even through our questions, even through our being perplexed, even through our pauses, even through our fears, it's a posture, or it's maybe developing a posture that's just with faith in God's word, that says yes, or is ready to say yes to God. You know, like whenever there's a mass shooting in America, it's very common to hear people offering thoughts and prayers. And it's so common that it's become kind of a joke. And it bothers me both, like the loose sort of weaselly way people talk about prayer, as well as the way prayer is mocked. Because I suspect that the people who say thoughts and prayers, or at least a lot of them, don't really pray. Or if they pray, they definitely don't pray like Mary. I suspect they don't come before God with a posture that's ready and eager and full of faith to say yes to God no matter what, to take God at his word, to know that he will not forget any of his promises to us. Because if people really prayed and prayed sort of like Mary prayed, I don't think they'd stop at just saying thoughts and prayers. They'd be willing to fight for safety and equity and human worth, and they would seek repentance from our collective sins. You know, like our church does this too. We pray that gun violence would be curbed. You know, we pray it with some frequency. And last winter, we passed out postcards. I don't know if you remember, some of you guys will remember this for sure. We passed out postcards last winter just to send, like, postcards to send to our representatives from whatever party. You know, just urging people, not with a specific, like, platform or certain method, but just urging representatives to that this is important, curbing gun violence somehow. When we talk about beginning with prayer, we're talking about like a posture. We're talking about just being ready to say yes to the Lord, ready to believe him at his word. That's the kind of prayer we're talking about, Mary-like prayer. All right, number two, praying is not just for ourselves. Praying is actually praying about others, praying about others. And we see this especially in Elizabeth. Elizabeth is praying. And she's not just like hearing stuff or praying stuff for herself. She actually receives a word about Mary. Real quick, you might be like, wait, Elizabeth is not really praying. She heard and understands something, but she's not really praying. Is she? Well, I think she is. We need to know that prayer is like two-way communication with God. Like we talk, and so does God. God listens, and so do we. And a big part of prayer is listening to God and listening specifically to the Holy Spirit who is with us. And Elizabeth here is a person of prayer, listening to God for other people, not just for herself. See, this is very different from non-Christian spiritualities of prayer that are out there, that are around us in our culture, that are, I think, mostly about like self-care and are very like self-focused. You know, when people talk about like, hey, you should pray. Have you tried praying? Like, oh, you should have some kind of spiritual discipline, spiritual practice. It's mostly like centered on yourself. They tend to be like very private. They tend to be focused on self. They focus on like, if they focus on mindfulness, it's mindfulness that's really centered on ourselves. Like in this moment, where am I? And Christian prayer is like different. Christian prayer is different. It's different. It's like for others. It's not just for ourselves. It's for others. And if you call it mindfulness, it's like a much, much bigger mindfulness. It's a mindfulness of God, but it's also a mindfulness of other people. Can you show that real stupid meme? So anyway, that's what Christian prayer is different. Christian prayer is characterized by considering other people. And considering other people, praying that way, it's almost more the rule than the exception. A while back, I heard a minister talking about praying the Psalms. And in this guy's tradition, ministers pray like these already picked multiple Psalms each day, different Psalms picked for each day. And he was saying that he struggled with it when he started doing it because the Psalms for that day would like often not match his own life or his own feelings. Like he'd be happy, and then that day the psalm would be a lament. Or he was feeling down, and the psalms for that day were joy and celebration. But he said that the turning point for him was when he realized that his praying the psalms was intercession. It was praying for other people, not just for himself. And so even if he was down and then had to pray a prayer of celebration, a psalm of celebration, he was praying that for people in his life or people in the world who had reasons to celebrate. And when he had to pray psalms of lament, he was praying for people who had reasons to lament before God, regardless of his own situation. Like, that's very Christian prayer. And, you know, I'll say a little plug for a prayer meeting on Tuesdays and small groups that are going to start in a couple weeks. Those are places where we actually listen to each other pray, and we actually pray for others, including each other in the room or in the Zoom. Not only does that rhyme, it's amazing to think about. I remember a couple years back, I wasn't in a small group for about a year, and then I was in one. And the most important or most like awesome part, the most awesome part for me was when like we prayed. And people actually were praying for me right there. And I was hearing them pray. It was like incredible. It was incredible. Just stop and think about it. It's incredible. Like you have people in the room just like praying for you and you're listening to them pray for you. You know, like this city and life generally can be lonely. And man, like it's a powerful thing to have, like just to hear people praying for you. That's awesome. So anyway, just a little plug for small group, little plug for prayer. Third thing. Part of prayer is just being joyful together. Prayer is not just like a religious and like severe and reverent. Like it's fun. Like it's meant to lead to joy. I don't think the takeaway needs to be that like we should pray and like cry out with joy in our prayer more. I mean, it could be that, but maybe it's okay if we don't cry out with joy that much. I don't know. Maybe Elizabeth didn't much either, and it's not every day, obviously, that she recognized that Jesus is coming in the flesh in her cousin's belly. You know, so it's a special day, and that's not happening for us today. But Elizabeth and Mary both, I think, model joyfulness through their prayer. And just to ask, like, is joy one of our goals when we pray? Is joy one of our goals when we pray? And I think here the story says, yeah, maybe it should be. Yes, prayer can be full of angst and anguish, but it can also be full of joy. And I think if you're used to more like kind of a religious sort of setting for prayer, maybe you tend to think that prayer is meant to be just severe. And if there's any feeling, it's more like angst and anguish. But let the Bible kind of open our world up. Prayer is about joy. We see this. Just let me read these last few verses of this passage again. Elizabeth heard the greeting of Mary, and the baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit, and she exclaimed with a loud cry, "Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb. Why is this granted to me that the mother of my Lord should come to me? Behold, when the sound of your greeting came to my ears, the baby in my womb leaped for joy." I'm going to just show some art. I have some more visuals besides that stupid Snoop Dogg meme. There's just some art over the centuries depicting this passage that we just read. The first one is by Jacques Daré from the 1400s. It shows the two women, by the way, it shows the two women looking a lot fairer and more European than Middle Eastern, we can say that. But if you're also like, who's that guy on the left? Like, I don't remember him. Like, well, let me read this again. There's some dude. He's just a contemporary priest that the painter is honoring, you know, by showing that he meditates on what's happening here. So this image, it's like very reverent. This picture is very reverent, but I don't think it's really joyful. And it's interesting to think. I'm not an art historian, so I don't want to say too much, but it's just interesting to me, at least, to think about how this period of European Christianity was maybe sort of the peak of religiousness in European Christianity right before the Reformation and Counter-Reformation, because it really needed Reformation, you know? It's just interesting to think about. A second image that we'll show is one, is a painting from the mid-1800s by a Danish painter, Carl Bloch, and again, the characters are fair-skinned, but there's open arms. It's hard to see, probably, but there's not quite a smile. You see sort of a shadow on Elizabeth's face, and might make out a smile, but I don't know, not quite. It's still like pretty severe. But jumping ahead to two recent pieces, the first is by Vicky Shuck. It has like a Southwestern feel. And we see Elizabeth is smiling. You know, she's on the right, she's smiling. That's really nice. And I feel like that gets a little closer to the feel and tone of this passage. She's not really crying out with joy, but at least she's smiling. And then finally, this one is by a guy named Corby Eisbach. And there's Elizabeth smiling, like with her mouth open. You who smile and laugh with your mouth open, you know, you're like Elizabeth. You know, she's laughing. Sound is coming out of her mouth, and it's like audible, maybe even loud. And I think this picture is closer to the feel of this passage, like exclaiming with a loud cry, you know. She's like joyful, you know. Can prayer, like, be fun? Can ministry rooted in prayer be fun? You bet. I'm just going to tell a real quick fun story. I just told this story. I hadn't thought about it for years, but I just told this story like a week ago. Not here, just in a conversation. So I'll just tell it real quick now. So this is like 15, 20 years ago. I was living in New York, and I was a pastor of a church there. And I had a co-pastor, a colleague, and he was working with our youth group at the time, like high school kids. And there was like a high school retreat during the summer, about like an hour and a half, 2 hours away, like in Atlantic City. And not like, it's like, what, you guys send your kids to Atlantic City? It's like in that area, I mean. And it's like, what kind of church do you want to? Anyway, this youth pastor like took like a van and took these kids, but then he got into an accident with the van and there was this issue. And anyway, he had to go to some kind of court like a month or two later. And he was in this courtroom or outside waiting for his time. And then he was sitting next to this random guy on a bench. And they started talking. And he's like, what do you do? And he's like, I'm a pastor. And the guy was like, that's amazing, because I've been wondering whether Jesus really is God. So it's great that I met you, you know? And my friend's like, what? You know, da-da-da. And he's like, could you come to my house? And I just moved in this house, and I feel like there's some problems there, da-da-da. Could you come and visit me? And so anyway, so a week or two later, he goes down, and I go with him because he didn't want to go by himself. It's like, I don't want to drive 2 hours. It's like random guy's house. I don't know what's going to happen to me. Just come with me, you know? And I'm like, fine, I'll go with you. we go down there, and we get to his, you know, little house, and then he's ready to experience a new life in Christ. He's ready to follow Christ. And so my friend, he leads him to, like, in a prayer, just saying yes to Christ. Real easy, right? It's like, man, that's so easy. Yeah, it's fun. It's that easy. You just get into accidents in Atlantic City. You know, this is just how it happens, you know? And then he was like, oh, you know, I feel like spiritual, like something, there's kind of weird things in my house. Can you just pray? And I'm like, all right, we'll pray. We didn't see anything or anything, but, you know, it's like, we'll just pray. But I just tell that story because it's like a fun story. You know, it's just like, it's kind of random. It's fun. But I don't know. What I like about that story is, like, me, mostly my friend, like, he was just ready to say yes. You know, he's ready to say yes. You know, we're in a posture just ready to bless other people, ready to drive like 2 hours to this random house, you know, around Atlantic City, you know. And there's like joy as we did it. It was just fun. It was unexpected. It was just fun. It's joyful. And our life isn't just about ourselves. It's like about other people. You know, our prayer isn't just about ourselves. It's about other people. And this is what we see in this passage. When we say begin with prayer, when we talk about blessed practice, when we say begin with prayer, we're talking about a posture that just has faith, that's ready to say yes to the Lord. God, I believe you at your word. I'm willing to roll with it. We're talking about not just praying for myself, not just a spiritual practice that's about myself and mindful of myself and where I am in this moment, but a practice that is about other people. That's about love. And prayer, that's connected to fun, connected to joy, connecting to, like, open mouth laughter. You know, that's what we're talking about here. Can we pray just for a moment? And then Pastor Chris is going to come back up here, and he's going to lead us in a sort of corporate prayer that we're going to say together. But just before the Lord, can just for a second, just for, I don't know, like 20 seconds, can you just think about Mary and Elizabeth? Think about their posture of prayer. Think about how they pray, not just for themselves, but for others. As they have joy through this ministry that they have in prayer. It's just, if there's anything in that that just jumps out at you a little bit more, can you just say something to God along the lines of that and just say yes to the Lord? Like, I want to learn from these sisters, Mary and Elizabeth. You know, make my prayer like that, Lord.
Church, let's continue responding to the Lord in prayer. We do this at our church sometimes. It's like a call and response where I'll say a prayer for us, for our community. And I'll end with, we give you all that we are and all that we have. And when I do, I want to invite you to say with me, have your way in us, to bless the world. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for creating us in your image. We thank you for the many gifts and giftings you've given us to share your love with others. Yet for some of us, many of us, we often give in to the lie that we don't have anything worth offering to you or to the world. Lord, help us see ourselves the way that you do, as sons and daughters, fearfully and wonderfully made, as your workmanship created in Christ Jesus to do good works that you've prepared in advance for us to do. And for others, it's easy to give in to the temptation to use and show off what we've been given for our own glory instead of pointing others to you. We repent of thinking too little or too much of ourselves. Help us to think and live rightly in accordance with your truth. We give you all that we are and all that we have. Have your way in us to bless the world. Thank you that you are a God who redeems our brokenness. You turn our ashes into beauty and renew us day by day. You are able to use every one of us and every one of our unique circumstances to bring about blessings to others where we are. So we put our trust and our faith in you, even when it's hard to see it. We give you all that we are and all that we have. Have your way in us to bless the world. We continue to pray for those you helped us call to mind last week. That you've placed, these are people you've placed in our lives to bless. And so I just want to invite you, church, to let's take a moment and pray for those people who last week you felt like the Lord brought to mind. If you're here for the first time this week, we just want to give just a moment of praying for people who we feel like God has uniquely placed in our lives that we can bless. And so let's take a moment and just pray over them. We give you all that we are and all that we have. We pray for our ministry partners who are praying these same types of prayers for their friends and neighbors. We pray for Little Lights, Casa Chirilagua, Global Gates, Ryla, that you would multiply the works of their hands in caring for their communities in this area. May the families and these communities experience the outpouring of your provision in powerful ways this year. Yes, on behalf of the greater body of Christ in this DMV region, we say, we give you all that we are and all that we have. We continue to pray for our country and countries around the world and those who govern them. Grant our leaders wisdom to pass good and just laws, and may their governance be for the good of all, not just a select few. Enlarge our prayers, too, to encompass not only a select few or people who are easy or obvious to us to pray for, but also to pray for those we may have overlooked, but whom you have not forgotten. So right now, too, we pray for the millions upon millions of displaced peoples in Sudan, in Syria, in the Democratic Republic of Congo, in Venezuela. You have not forgotten them. We give you all that we are and all that we have. Father, we know that you can work with or without us, but we ask for the privilege to be used by you as you bring about your rule here on earth as it is in heaven. We trust you are forming us right now in this worship to love and do what you love and do. In your never-ending rule over all things, you love and do goodness, selflessness, power, just ways, righteous ways, equity, understanding, and a holy fear of you. God, let us take opportunities to do good to others. We pray for others, not just ourselves. We pray for people to see your powerful healing and compassion. We give ourselves as advocates for people who are taken advantage of or not cared for. We pray for the sick for healing. We pray for those who don't have health insurance to somehow have access to health care. We ask for knowledge and development that liberates and honors people. We give you all that we are and all that we have. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Church, on the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and broke it and said, "This is my body broken for you." In the same way, he took the cup and said, "This is the new covenant, which is my blood poured out for the forgiveness of your sins." When you eat of it and you take of it, you proclaim my death and resurrection until I come again. And so, church, we're going to be taking communion together. The elements are in the back table. And as we do that, let's remember that for Christ, it says that it was for joy, the joy that was set before him, that he endured the cross. And us who are believers, as we're united into Christ's body and united together as one, this same Christ is now seated at the right hand of God, interceding on our behalf. And so as he intercedes for us and we're united to him, let's remember that as we take it, and let's remember to intercede for others. And so, church, I want to invite you, let's go and take it together. But before we do that, there is a proclamation that we say together. The mystery of our faith is great.
Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Please come. Let's take the elements together.
Sacrifice, Lord, I offer you my
stand if you're able.
Shape us, Lord, how you develop us as people who are not just optimistic, but people who live with faith in you and what you say. Lord, we want to be people and help other people as well to be just those who say yes to you. Just even now, church, just we're just in the presence of the Lord and He's strengthening us. We'll be sent out just in a moment, but just enjoy His presence just for a moment here before we are sent out. He's strengthening us. He's making us say yeses to Him. Now, friends, in the power of the Holy Spirit, in the love of Christ, in the goodness of God, we're sent out to other people. We're always sent out with other people. So let's go be that for other people. Let's go blessing other people, capital B-L-E-S-S, blessing other people, praying with love, praying with faith, praying with yeses, and praying with joy. Amen. Thanks so much for joining us. We'll see you soon. Next week, we'll be at the park.